Welcome to Levi Stadium. This is my second home during part of the NFL season. And we're here to kind of talk about, right over my shoulder, where we have the company Tesla, one of the biggest EV makers in the world, and the home of autonomous driving. So let's talk about those electric vehicles. They're amazing, luxurious. They have amazing seats, great embroidery, great cup holders. Everybody would like to be in them. They ride great, full of great technology. They're kind of like these box seats here at the stadium. These are the ones you'd like to own, but not everybody can afford these. It's not realistic. Most folks are sitting in these seats. They're plastic. They're harder, a little bit rougher ride. And so they can't take and have this type of thing in their budget. That's not where folks like me and my wife and my family usually get to be without some types of incentives or discounts or special leases. Here in California, 20% of the vehicles are electric, but that still means 80% of them aren't. In the United States, it's more like 90%. That's a lot of vehicles that aren't electric. For that to happen, we've got to be able to take and make these affordable vehicles ride like these expensive vehicles, and we got to make them accessible, and we got to give them the range so that people can afford them. As long as electric vehicles are priced like the seats that are in places like this, there's no way that the average person is going to be able to afford an electric vehicle. Not everybody can have somebody like my friend Ed taking care of them with their box seats. Most of us are just going to have to go to the concession stand. Good to see you, Ed.
You too, Chris.
Appreciate you. So if you're trying to think about getting one of these EVs, but you're on this concession stand budget, how can you even think about something like autonomy, which is the exciting thing of the day? And you're looking at all these vehicles that are doing self-driving, but the last thing that you're thinking about is a vehicle that can drive itself. Well, let's gain some perspective about autonomy and just how common it is, because although you may be seeing it out there, I'm not sure if it is something that is as common as people might think it is in our bubble. You're talking about one seat or a row of seats in a world of cars that don't do anything like what we're talking about or what Tesla or Rivian is hoping to do. So in the future, you can imagine all of these seats being the automotive equivalent of a stadium full of vehicles that are driving themselves. And so this is the aspiration of an automotive dream that will see all of us basically owning vehicles that will be able to take us anywhere we want to go without us ever having to intervene. But for today, there's only a handful, maybe a row, if you will, of vehicles that can do this in a world of vehicles that can't. Now, in this part of my world, what gets announced here is pretty much gospel. What you hear is going to happen. Things are signed. Things are going to hit the field. But in the world of automotive, you might get an announcement and it never occurs. What you see at the auto show may not be what makes it to the showroom floor at your dealer. And what they announce at the podium as the next Model T moment, it may change in a couple years and may look totally different. All right, so am I saying they should stay on the sidelines for this type of stuff? No, absolutely not. They need to start developing these electric vehicles. They need to get involved with autonomy. So what are they going to do? That's a big question. In 2027, Ford is starting to come out with some affordable EVs. I'm excited to see what those are and do they include autonomy. Some other automakers have to get involved. It can't just be Rivian and Ford doing this stuff. Let's talk more about that and let's get more in depth on this topic. So just down the street from the stadium, I'm here at the campus of NVIDIA, one of the companies that we're going to see in the marketplace across a wide range of vehicles. Everything from Lucid to Waymo to Zeekr, to anything you can imagine, including one of the feature-rich products we've seen from Mercedes. Now, what we're seeing from the team here at NVIDIA is really impressive, and this is a team I hope to speak with more in depth one day. But what I've noticed in their partnership with Mercedes is a lot of progress when it comes to autonomous driving, much further along than what we saw from Rivian during their autonomy day. I'll put some video here. You can see them navigating very well through the streets of San Francisco, which is no small feat. Them being able to take a vehicle and drive it through the streets with all the different traffic and then be able to make turns and have vehicles on the side that they have to navigate around, pedestrians, hand signals, all of that kind of thing, was pretty remarkable. And although it wasn't completely perfect, and I don't think it's anywhere close to where FSD is today, it really shows the capability of what they're fundamentally doing with their hardware and their software stacks and their sensors. And what they've developed gives them a starting point for a number of different diverse manufacturing and automotive options out there. And that's going to drive the cost of this stuff down and give a lot of options for different manufacturers to use. And that's important to what we're talking about, which is making this stuff widely available at lower cost. And this is important to understand because not everybody's going to be able to do this themselves. They don't have Tesla's engineering and they don't have the funding to be able to start from scratch. So to be able to take something like they're doing here at NVIDIA and use that as a platform to launch from is going to be a huge step forward in lowering the cost. And you can see vehicles behind me, like the one from Waymo, are using this type of technology, and we see these all over the Bay Area. Now, Tesla uses just camera and not LiDAR at all. Let's talk about them. Tesla, of course, is the leader at this, but at $40,000 to $50,000 plus another $8,000 for FSD, this is not going to solve the mass market problem and is not going to give us mass adoption. When it comes to all of these vehicles, this is really the benchmark and this is the standard, but this isn't going to get us to 50% of the market. This isn't going to get us to affordability. So what is? How do we get there? Let's talk about Ford and their plans and what we think they're going to be doing to try to solve it. It's not going to be the full answer, but it's going to be a big step. Let's go over there. So let's talk about what Ford is doing to bridge that cost gap. Some really remarkable plans are in place going forward for what they call the universal electric vehicle. They're going to be using some new manufacturing processes that are going to allow it to compete with what's going on in China. And that's really important because in order to bring the cost down, they're going to have to revolutionize the way that cars are put together. And so they're hoping to get to a $30,000 price point, which is going to allow it to compete in the marketplace at a level that's never been done before. There's certainly vehicles out there like the Nissan Leaf or the Chevy Bolt, which are kind of in that price range, but not with the technology that we're hoping to see. So here at the Greenfield Labs, this is where Ford is developing their latest in ADAS technology. This is also where the Lightning was born, and of course where the technology for the Mach-E was born, and where they're working on the future for their level 2, level 2++, and their level 3 technology. This is the stuff that they were talking about at CES this week. So that's where things get exciting, because they're talking about the next generation of vehicles being for everybody and coming with this type of autonomy from the start. How they're going to accomplish that is interesting. Firstly, they've moved a lot of their key hardware in-house so that their module, their core that controls a lot of their ADAS and their infotainment, that piece is now being done by Ford, and that vertical integration means they control it, and that will bring the cost down. It will also be greatly simplified from an engineering perspective, and we're talking about zonal architecture and software-defined vehicles. Now, one of the things they're developing with this platform is a level 2, level 2++ type of autonomy, which will give you point-to-point navigation, and that will include being able to navigate through intersections, stoplights, things that weren't previously available with BlueCruise. Now, this will still be a supervised type of autonomy, but what they are also looking to develop is something on highway driving that will be not only hands-off, but eyes-off navigation, and that's something we have never seen before from Ford. Now that's exciting because those long road trips, that's where you're going to really see the value and get your time back and be able to do something that right now not even Tesla delivers on. Now I certainly don't expect to see that in 2027. That's going to take a little bit longer to develop, and I personally don't expect that to see within the city navigation. That's something that Ford is a little bit more cautious with, especially with the brand. So they've talked before about on earnings call, when it comes to things like level 4 autonomy, that might be a partnership thing or a licensing thing. They were asked at CES if they would ever partner on FSD, and that's one of those things that today they don't think that they need to do. but in the future, they're not opposed to it. They are certainly open to licensing agreements and doing things with partners in the future. When they talked about LiDAR and radar, they definitely said that they think that radar and cameras is the way to go for level two, but that LiDAR was going to be needed for level three and above. That is their current take with current technology. That may change as things start to develop from all the different folks, like we've seen from NVIDIA and Tesla, as they evolve and more people use it. Of course, they have been known to pivot. And of course, as we said earlier, not everything announced at a podium or at a trade show or being shown at CES is what's going to be revealed or rolled out a year or two later. So you can expect to see Ford bring this technology to the next generation of F-150, Super Duty, Diesel, Bronco, as well as the Universal Electric platforms. There's a lot of excitement there across the entire lineup. They're also really leaning into their AI in a different way, so that if you're off-roading your vehicle and you want to know if you can traverse an area, it might tell you to deflate your tires. It might tell you if an obstacle is coming up. So that AI is going to be really customizable for the vehicle you're in. Or if you're at a hardware store with your truck, it might be able to tell you if the items are going to fit in your bed. So in that way, it's something very unique in terms of the way that it's going to interact with the customer. So they're really leaning into their customer base. And I really appreciated the way that they're taking their personal AI assistant and doing it different than Rivian. When the Rivian demonstrated how it was going to be used, it was very tech bro. It was very much, hey, can you change my lunch schedule? I'm going to go for an avocado sandwich with my buddy, but I need to change my lunch date, as opposed to, hey, I'm at Home Depot, or hey, I'm off-roading and rock crawling. It's a very different demographic. But the big focus and excitement for me is to see that affordable electric vehicle in the manufacturing process, in the software flexibility, and in the flexibility of it to make both a mid-sized truck and an SUV option, because currently there is no more Ford Edge or Focus or Escape. So what they're gonna be able to do with that, even maybe going into a van option, that's where it's gonna be really interesting, especially on an electric platform. But there's still a missing component, even with the software and the manufacturing and bringing the cost down at $30,000, there's still one obstacle, and that's the battery pack. Now, they're going to be doing manufacturing with CATL licensing of LFP batteries, and that's definitely a step forward. That's definitely a cost reduction, first of its kind in the United States to manufacture LFP here in the U.S. But I think there's even something more exciting coming. Let's talk about that next. So we've talked about how NVIDIA is changing the world of autonomous driving and how Ford is going to transform the way they're manufactured. But this is the key component that's missing as far as cost, and that is battery technology. You join me here at Verge, and Verge is all the rage right now because they are introducing solid state batteries, a huge step in the cost. These right here are the current models of motorcycle that we've got here in Santa Clara, San Jose at the mall. Now, the next evolution of these that are coming out later this year in March will have solid state. This company, Verge, is also the same company that spun off Donut Labs. Donut Labs is making the next version of these that will have solid state technology, and this is the key. They're looking to have 1 gigawatt of production and then eventually ramp up to 10, and that is the type of scale that you need to do automotive manufacturing. At that point, the whole world changes, and now we can start looking at having a marketplace that starts to get competitive with gas, and that is what we've been talking about this whole time. Getting the cost down and affordability to the point where every family can go electric, because it's not going to be a situation where only people that can afford $50,000 and $60,000 cars can afford it. Those are still $600 and $700 car payments. That's not something I can afford. But these vehicles, if you pair them with manufacturing progress like Ford is making and battery technology that can go 600 miles or has half the weight and can go 300 miles, this type of scale, this changes the game. Simplicity is also going to be important. Getting things affordable means keeping them simple. So having vehicles that get down to $15,000, $20,000 is going to be what really is the key to the future in electrifying things. Of course, charging matters as well. These things are going to be able to charge in 5, maybe 10 minutes. So that is the type of thing that really puts it on par with gas. So let me know what you think. Does this convince you? With everything you've heard about from Ford, from Verge, from everything you've seen from NVIDIA, is this the future of transportation? Can you see the cost getting lower? Can you see yourself in an EV? Drop a comment below. Hope you like these videos. If you do, and this is your kind of stuff, subscribe. Hype it up if you're on mobile. And check out my other videos. And hope you watch more of what I've done here. We'll see you on the next one, guys.